Can you hear me?
Now I hear you, yes.
All right. All right, everyone. Well, good morning and welcome to Understanding Grief and Loss presentation brought to you by United Healthcare. For those of you who don't know me or haven't met me, my name is Gail Diedrich and I'm your health engagement nurse with United Healthcare. And today we're going to discuss understanding grief and loss. So we've all suffered at varying levels from the coronavirus pandemic, right? And it is expected that someone will grieve after the loss of a parent, a sibling, partner, child, or best friend. But those aren't the only losses that lead to grief. Like, people may grieve the loss of a treasured pet, a job, or other important role in life, such as a home or other emotionally significant possessions, right? So it often occurs after a divorce. So at some level, we've all experienced grief and loss. So today we'll move into slide two, objectives, and we'll be talking about grief and loss. We'll learn about grief, then discuss the stages of grief. We'll then talk about managing grief and grief in children and teens. And finally, we'll discuss some resources to help you with grief. But before I start, I just wanted to say this to everyone. Grief is personal and individual, and every person experiences its nuances differently, right? So your personality, your support system, your natural coping mechanisms, and many other things will determine how loss will affect you. So there are no rules, no timetables, no linear progressions, and some people feel better after a few months or a few weeks, and others, it may take years and they may never get over it. And in the midst of recovery, there may be setbacks. So this nonlinear process can't be controlled, and it's critical that you treat yourself with patience and compassion and allow the process to unfold. So moving into to slide three, we'll discuss facts to know. So grief is a natural response to the loss of someone or something very important to you. The loss may cause sadness. It may cause you to think of very little else besides the loss. The words sorrow and heartache are often used to describe feelings of grief. Grieving is the process of emotional and life adjustment you go through after a loss. So grieving after a loved one's death is also known as bereavement. Grieving is a personal experience. I can't say it enough. It is a personal experience depending on who you are and the nature of your loss. Your process of grieving will be different from another person's experience. So there is no normal and expected period of time for grieving. Moving into slide four. What causes grief? So grief and grieving are the natural response to a major loss, such as the death of a loved one. Loss may cause feelings of grief, sometimes when you least expect it, right? You may find that old feelings of grief from past loss can be triggered by current experiences or anniversaries of that loss. So this is normal. So grief can happen from any major change or loss. The loss, like I said, of a loved one. It may be the loss of a pet. It may be the loss of a job. It could just be moving or just a simple breakup from a relationship. So moving into the next slide, slide five, we're going to talk about emotions of grief. So a wide range of feelings and symptoms are common during grieving. So, excuse me. While you're feeling shock, numbness, sadness, anger, guilt, anxiety, or sometimes even fear, you may also find moments of relief, peace, or happiness. And although grieving is not simply sadness, the blues, or depression, you may become depressed or overly anxious during the grieving process. So grief may take, it may make people feel overwhelmed. People may lose interest in activities they used to enjoy, such as jogging, such as hanging out with friends, going to church. So always check on your loved ones. They may lose sleep, or they may actually sleep more. They may have changes in their appetite. They may eat more, they may eat less. And these are all normal responses to loss or change. Moving into slide six. So, have you all heard of Elizabeth Kubler-Ross? In 1969, she actually introduced the five stages of grief after working with terminally ill individuals. And while the model of grief was originally created for people who were ill, it also applies to any experience of loss. So the five stages of grief are denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. So grief is very personal. So not everyone will go through all the five stages, and not everyone will go through them in this order. You can go through acceptance, and then after everything is done and your family and everyone is gone, then you go through the denial, anger. There is no correct order to go through when it comes to grieving. There's no set length of time that it takes to go through the stages either. You can experience some quickly, and others may take longer periods of time. So if you need help coming with the feelings, and changes from grief, a mental health professional is a very good resource to help you work through your feelings and emotions. So let's take a look at all the stages of grief. We'll talk through it, and we'll start with denial. So moving into slide seven. So in the Kubler-Ross model, it's not unusual to respond to the intense and sudden feelings of grief by pretending that the loss or change isn't happening. So denying may give you more time to deal with the new and begin the process and process the new reality. And denial is very common defense mechanism, right? That may help you calm when you are intense of that situation. So, as people move out of the denial stage, emotions may begin to bubble to the surface. You may have to deal with the sorrow and feelings that of the denied. These feelings may be difficult to deal with, but it is a very important part of the journey through the grief. So, some examples of what the denial stage may look like is a response to a breakup. There may be upset. This will be over tomorrow. Dealing with a job loss. They'll call tomorrow and, they'll say that they still need you. Response to the death of a loved one. He's not gone. He'll walk through the door any minute. Dealing with a terminal illness diagnosis. The test results must be wrong. And this is not happening. So these are just examples of denial. This can't be happening to me. Why me? Whatever the loss is, it's not happening. It's not real. And it will change. You'll wake up tomorrow and it will all be better. It's normal to think that way. It's just this process that you have to go through. And it is the stage and example of denial. So moving into slide eight. Now let's move into anger. So unlike denial, anger is masking effect. It's not a coping mechanism, right? The anger that you may feel hides the emotion and pain that you may have. So people experience anger in different ways. You may get direct anger towards a person, the person that died, an old coworker, a family member. You may also direct anger towards an inanimate object. You may break your car. You may break your phone. You may, toss your bag. You may break your glasses. You may kick the wall. The feelings of anger may be so intense that your rational brain can't stop you from directing your anger at the wrong person or object. So anger often masks the bitterness and resentment. Not everyone will experience this stage, and not everyone will experience it at the same intensity. But once you work through the anger, you may begin, okay, to think more rational and be able to deal with the emotions you've been masking. So some examples of anger stage might look like in response, like to a breakup, going back to the breakup, I hate him, you know, he'll never find anyone else as good as me. A reaction to a job loss, maybe that was an awful job anyways, I didn't need it, I didn't like the job anyways, right? I hope they fail without me. Another example is after the death of a loved one, you may feel if you have fought harder, this wouldn't have happened. If you had done things differently, this wouldn't have happened. If you went to the doctor earlier, this wouldn't have happened. Response to a terminal illness diagnosis, how dare God let this happen to me? Like, why me? These are examples of anger. And it's normal, and it's part of the grieving process. Moving into slide 9, we'll talk about bargaining. So often during periods of grief, you may be helpless, you may be vulnerable. Bargaining is a way to curb that helplessness and vulnerability in an effort to regain control of the situation. So in the bargaining stage of grief, you may create a lot of what if, and if only statements, right? So bargaining may help to postpone the sadness, the confusion, or hurt that you may be feeling. So it's not uncommon for religious individuals to attempt to make a deal with a higher power in return for healing and relief from the pain of grief. Some examples are, let's go back to the breakup. If only I had been better, she would have stayed. In relation to a job loss, if I would have worked 12-hour days, that would, you know, they would see me for what I was worth. In relation to a death of a loved one, if only I had answered that phone call, she wouldn't be gone. In relationship to a terminal illness diagnosis, if we had gone to the doctor sooner, this wouldn't have happened. So these are all examples of bargaining. It's a part of grieving that we have to go through. So moving into slide 9, we'll talk about depression. In the early stages of loss, you may be trying to hide from your emotions, but at this stage, you may be able to work through those emotions in a healthier way. You may isolate yourself from others in an effort to deal with the loss. Depression is not easily defined because everyone deals with it differently, right? You may feel overwhelmed. You may feel groggy. You may feel heavy. You feel confused. And people may feel stuck at the stage of grief. And this is a great time to reach out to like a mental health professional. A therapist may be helpful on helping you work through the stages of grief. So some examples of the depression stages may look like, we'll go back to the breakup again. Why go on at all? You know, I can't go on. I there's no way that I can live without him or her. In relation to a job loss, I don't know how to keep going. In relationship to a death of a loved one, what am I going to do without him or her? You know, I can't live. Terminal illness diagnosis. My whole life comes to this horrible end. These are all examples of depression. Be mindful of it. Listen to your loved ones. Listen to your colleagues and be there for them and support them. Moving into slide 11, we're going to talk about acceptance. Acceptance is unique, right? It is not necessarily a happy or uplifting stage of grief. It doesn't mean that you've moved on from the grief or loss, but rather it means that you have accepted and you have understand how your life may be different now without that person, how your life may be different without that job. This stage may make you feel very different because you've had a major change in your life. Often people explain acceptance, that there may be more good days than bad days ahead. And they're still looking for the bad days, but it's okay. And some examples of acceptance stage, going back to the breakup, is I can see now that this wasn't healthy for me. That's part of the acceptance. In relationship to a job loss, you may think, I'll be able to find something else down a different path. Death of a loved one, I'm happy that I had so many good years with him, and I'll always have the happy memories of him. That's part of acceptance. In relationship to a terminal illness, I can tie things up and make sure that I get everything done. You know, I want to do the final weeks. I want to do the final weeks and the final months, right? So it is very hard when you get a terminal illness diagnosis and that person has acceptance. I don't block that person. Just know that you have to just be there, and this is their coping mechanism to get through the final weeks and to get through the final months. Moving into slide 12, grief. Grief may cause stress, right? So, which may negatively affect your health in multiple ways, including digestion. So the rush of hormones and the rapid breathing and increased heart rate may upset your digestive system. You're more likely to have heartburn or acid reflux, and that's thanks to the increase in stomach acid. Stress may also affect the way food moves through your body, leading to diarrhea or constipation. You might also experience nausea, vomiting, or a stomach ache. Heart, brain, and blood vessels, it affects that, right? Under stress, your heart pumps faster. Think about when you get the news, you know, of a loss, or you're grieving. Your heart pumps faster. Your stress hormone causes your blood vessels to constrict and divert more oxygen to your muscles, so you'll have more strength to take action. But this also raises your blood pressure. Also a result of frequent or chronic stress, it will also make your heart work harder too fast for too long. So when your blood pressure rises, so does your risk for having a stroke or a heart attack. How many times have we heard someone have received like a bad news and then they suffer a massive stroke or a heart attack? This is the reason why it raises your blood pressure, is the massive amount of constriction of the blood vessels and blood flowing through the organs, which causes great pressure and causes a stroke or a heart attack. It has an effect on your immune system. So stress stimulates the immune system, which might be a plus for immediate situations, but this stimulation may help you avoid infections and heal wounds. But over time, stress hormones will weaken your immune system and reduce your body's response to foreign invaders, right? So people under chronic stress are more susceptible to viral illnesses like the flu. You'll get, you know, the common cold, as well as other infections, especially now we have so many variants of the COVID virus. Stress may also increase the time that it takes you to recover from an illness or injury. So you have to take care of your immune system. You have to take care of yourself. Even though you're grieving, even though you're mourning, even though you've suffered a loss, your immune system is vital, okay? Because once that is compromised and it's weakened, then foreign invaders will take over. It makes it easier for foreign invaders to take over. Your weight, stress and grief affects your weight. So cortisol makes you crave fats and carbohydrates, which cause you to gain weight. And the cortisol also makes you more likely to put on weight in your abdominal area. So weight gain in this area raises your risk for heart disease, and it also raises your risk for diabetes. Mental health, your central nervous system is in charge of your flight or flight response. So in your brain, the hypothalamus gets the ball rolling. It's telling your adrenaline glands to release the stress hormones, adrenaline and cortisol, right? So these hormones rev up your heartbeat and send blood rushing through the areas that need it most in an emergency, such as your muscles, such as your heart, and your other vital important organs. So when the perceived fear is gone, the hypothalamus should tell all systems to go back to normal. So if the central nervous system fails to return to normal, or if the stressor doesn't go away, the response will continue. Chronic stress is also a factor in behavior, such as overeating or not eating enough, such as alcohol or drug abuse or even social withdrawal. So moving into slide 13. Working through the grief. So here are some things that may help you and your family work through the grief. Connect with family and friends. Reach out to family or friends or coworkers by phone, by text, by email, or video calls. It helps to talk about it. Part of grief is thinking that no one else is feeling the same thing. So when you talk about it, you see that you're not alone, that there are others who are going through similar situations. Exercise. Exercise at home, to music or online video or yoga. Exercising may help your mind and body stay healthier. Walking and riding a bike, are safe ways to exercise. Just be sure to talk to your doctor before significantly increasing your activity. Relax. This may be the great time to learn relaxation or visualization techniques or to start a mindfulness practice. There are many sources of these online. It could just be 5 minutes. Take 5 minutes throughout the day. Like every 3 hours or every 4 hours, take 5 minutes, shut down your lights, shut down your computers, or just close your eyes in your office and just breathe. Just breathe for a minute. Breathe for a minute and just breathe in, inhale in and exhale out. And just take a minute or 5 minutes for yourself. Keep a healthier diet. Try to keep up with your healthy eating and eat regularly. You may, because you're grieving, you may forget to eat, you fall into this depression. You have to eat and try to eat regularly. Taking care of your body helps your mind stay well too. So during time of grief, many people will turn to food more than ever. Please be mindful when nourishing your body. What you put in is what you get out. So, don't turn to the unhealthy foods. Try your best to stay with your healthy snacks and your healthy meals. Talk with your family. Talk together as a family about the changes and sacrifices that you're being asked to make. Help young children to talk about their feelings or their fears, or let them know that it is safe to do so. Be open to answers, questions, and concerns that children may have, and how to work together to cope through these feelings. Professional help. Reach out to a professional for help. Many counselors and therapists are offering phone or video call appointments. You also have the virtual visits available through your insurance. Make an appointment. Talk to a professional. Professionals can help you, handle strong feelings. Be mindful and don't be shy to ask for help. And it is not weak to ask for help. So, moving into slide 14, there are some self-care tips that may be helpful. So, writing in a journal may be a way to engage in self-expression and get things off your chest. I know, when I'm grieving or when I know I need to do something, then I start writing, and reading it over again and again will put things into perspective for me. Talking with others may keep you connected. Practicing mindfulness and relaxation techniques may help you maintain a balance. Maintaining a healthier diet along with sleep and exercise may go a long way in improving how you feel. Remember to take some time off or just take some time for yourself. Avoid or limit caffeine. Do not use alcohol. It's just a quick fix. A golden rule is you can't take care of other people unless you take care of yourself. So if you don't take anything, if you take nothing else from this section, please remember this. Treat yourself with kindness, treat yourself with compassion, and without judgment. You have the right to grieve, and no one, including yourself, can tell you when it's time and when to end the process. So, moving into slide 15, an employee assistance program or EAP is a free, voluntary, and confidential service offered through your employer to help you and your family with your well-being. I know through your EAP, you actually get 6 free visits. Use it, utilize it. Some of the services EAP may provide include mental health, in-person and telephonic access to licensed counselors 24 hours per day, 7 days a week, online resources, financial. They can help you with legal resources. They may also help you with elder care, child care. Speak with one of your on-site representatives, speak with myself, or reach out to Farah or reach out to Shanti to help you find resources throughout UnitedHealthcare through your insurance that you can tap into. I know Carly and Charlotte, they're there to help you obtain more information. So utilize your resources around you. Moving into slide 16, there are also many community organizations that you can tap into to help support your mental health and your emotional well-being. Depicted on your slides are just a few ideas of where to seek support in your community. NAMI and AMI host free classes and support groups for individuals, families, caregivers, and professionals. I know one, there's a local one in West Palm Beach. Local NAMI chapters are located throughout the United States, and one is most likely in your community. You can go to the website to learn more. Reach out to me if you want me to help you find a resource. There's also the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline and Veterans Crisis Lifeline that's available 24/7. You can also speak to a licensed counselor there. There are other resources, including like your support groups, hospitals, or even places of worship. Speak to someone, you're on site. Call me in finding programs in your area. There are also, finding grief support. One of the critical factors in healing, I have to say, one of the critical factors in healing from a grief is the support of other people, having support from your family, your friends, your community. From others who have also experienced grief, also. You may also talk to someone else who, I want to say, get it, right? So, someone else who have been there, who have experienced the same loss or something similar. Being able to share your story or your feelings is vital to the healing process. Places that you can find support also includes your faith-based groups, right? So if you're religious, if you may find support in your community, through your church, through your temple, they may be able to provide, suggestions for rituals, for prayers, that may help. And because of their role in the community, they may have like extensive experience in loss. There are different support groups. Reach out to them. There are many types of support groups that are both general and specific types of losses. If this feels intimidating, remember that you can attend a group and just listen. You don't have to participate. You can just sit there. You can just listen. You won't be forced to speak until you're comfortable, and you may draw comfort from being in a community of others who have had similar understanding of the depth of your grief. You can talk to Like I said, talk to your therapist, talk to your counselor, go out into the community and find network support. Reach out to me if you're suffering, if you're having difficulty finding support in your area, reach out to me. I can help you with that. I can call, schedule an appointment. It is very important for you to get help and for you to connect so you can work through the grieving process. Let's move into slide 17. So children see loss and death in different ways as they grow and develop. Tailor your help according to your child's age and emotional development. Not all children mature and develop the same, right? So make sure that you tailor your help according to their age. How you learn to deal with loss will affect how you help your child. So tell other significant adults in your child's life about his or her recent loss. So some childcare providers, such as teachers, school counselors, may also be able to help your child work through his or her grief. So communicate with the teachers, communicate with the school counselors. Let them know that your child have experienced a loss or is grieving, so they understand, so they know when they lash out or they go through the five stages of grieving, the denial, the bargaining, the anger, that they may not be misjudged. So communicate with them. And there are steps for helping children during the grieving process, like providing safety and security. So to express there, you have to be able to provide safety and security for children so they can express their feelings related to the loss. So children need an adult who makes them feel safe and secure. So consider your child's personality and his or her comfort level in talking about feelings and concerns. Consider the child's emotional development. So think about the child's age and feelings when you explain loss and death so that you can explain it in a way that he or she will understand. Use an activity. Activities create different ways for children to express their feelings related to loss. Try an activity that fits your style and your child's developmental level. So if one activity doesn't work, try another one. Some suggestions include like reading a book or watching DVDs. Books and DVDs can help children understand the concept of loss and death. Ask a librarian about books and DVDs for children your child's age. And after reading the book or watching the DVD, talk to your child about the story and especially about his or her feelings. It's important that you speak to your children, speak to them about their feelings. Make up stories. Storytelling lets you and your child change what happens in the story. Your child can change sad and gloomy feelings to more positive ones that provide warmth and comfort. Draw pictures. Drawing pictures of feelings may be easier than talking about them. So ask your child to draw a picture of what is happening to him or her. You can also draw a picture of what is happening to you, right? So after finishing your drawing, explain what you drew and ask your child to explain his or her picture. You can use the drawing pictures along with the storytelling to help the child deal with grief. Play or act, depending on the child's age, right? You may play or act. So act out feelings through play. May be a way to help children. You can use stuffed animals, you can use puppets, you can use toys to act out what is going on. Sometimes it is easier for the child to allow a favorite stuffed animal to speak for him or her. And it may be easier for a young child to talk with the animal, either alone or with an adult present, and then talk directly to the adult. Evaluate the activity. Observe your child during and after activity. So, what emotions did your child express during the activity? Listen to your child. What emotions did your child express afterwards? Talk to your child about these emotions. Let your child know that all feelings are normal. clear up all misconceptions he or she may have. So practice one of these activities above in the presence of another adult, and after the activity, ask the adult to tell you how effective they think the activity was for your child. So finally, don't try to keep grieving a private affair, okay? Ask child care providers such as teachers, school counselors to help your child express their feelings, concerns, and misconceptions. Moving into slide 18, you may feel unsure about how to approach a teen who is grieving. Teens, they have mixed emotions, right? There are some general concepts to keep in mind. So let your teen react to the loss in his or her way. Some teens are naturally quiet and may need to express their grief in private. Some teens feel so frustrated and helpless that they may react strongly, even showing intense rage. They may need reassurance that their intense feelings are normal reactions to a stressful situation. Allow your teen to ask questions. Teens who experience loss often question the meaning of life. So what happens after death? Why does tragedy occur? And why bad things happen to good people? You can best help your teen by allowing him or her to ask questions. Don't shut them out. Let them ask their questions. Give your teen time to adjust to a loss. So teens vary in their ability to adjust major changes, including losses in their lives. So your teen may not be ready to respond to a loss the same time as you, the family, and other people are. You need to understand that. Do not force your teen to grieve on a timetable. Let them grieve at their own, within their own time, okay? Reassure your teen that grieving is normal. Your teen may need reassurance that, you know, the sadness and all the feelings of grief will lessen over time. Use comforting touches and even hugs to help convey your understanding and love. Set reasonable limits on your teen's behavior. So when a major loss occurs in a teen's life, rebellious behaviors may become more dramatic, right? So this is often a sign that a teen is having intense feelings about what just happened. So teens usually feel more comfortable when they're clear about how far they can go with their behavior. Be firm with your teen and clear about your expectations of him or her. So there are some ways that you can help your teen in grieving. You can teach your teen about the normal grieving process, because teens normally have mood swings, right? And conflicted feelings. They may need help. Telling the difference between normal feelings and feelings of grief. Talk to your teen about the grieving process. Listen. Listen to your teen. Be prepared to drop what you're doing and listen to your child, okay? When he or she is ready to talk about the loss, it is time for you to put down what you're doing and listen. Let your teen talk about the loss in indirect ways. So if he or she needs to listen, listen to them express. Listen for feelings from your teen in expressing. Listen to what they're saying. Watch their face, facial expressions, their hand gestures, their body behaviors. Adults often want to help a teen or ease a teen's pain, right? So resist the urge to help your teen by talking, offering advice, or solving his or her problems. Let the teen use his or her own problem-solving skills. Listen and respond in a way that shows you're trying to understand what's being said. And this may encourage your teen to talk more, because they're so easy to shut down, and they'll tell you, oh, forget it, you don't understand anyway. That's why it's very important to let them use their own problem-solving skills. Handle serious behavior problems appropriately. So sometimes a teen's behavior does not improve when reasonable limits have been set by adults. Start by calming, talking to your teen about problem behavior. Seek professional counseling from your teen. Seek professional counseling for your teen, I'm sorry, or for yourself. So if you are not able to handle problem behaviors on your own, tell someone. Tell other significant adults in your teen's life about your teen's recent loss. Like I always tell parents, tell the teachers, tell the counselors, tell the coaches, and they may be able to work with your teen through his or her grief. Children will usually open up to those who they feel very comfortable with. Moving into slide 19, helping teens with grief. So following are some activities you can do with the different ages of teens to help when they're grieving. For early teens, since these teens may feel ill at ease when expressing grief, ask your teen to draw a picture, make a picture, call it, and or write a story or poem about his or her loss. Talk about the feelings that are expressed in the activity. For middle teens, since they cannot imagine their own death and often think that they will live forever, middle teens need activities that express feelings in a healthy way. Look at photographs with them. Watch a sad movie or listen to sad songs with your teen. Use the time to let your teen talk or just sit quietly. For the late teens, although late teens grieve more like adults, they may not want to participate in activities associated with major loss. For example, they may not be able to help other people after a natural disaster or attend a service for a deceased relative. Respect your teen's position. Do not force your teen to participate in activities that he or she doesn't feel comfortable doing. It may interfere with his or her ability to grieve. Your teen will grieve on his or her own time. Help your teen find activities to express his or her grief, such as a private service at home for the loved one who have died. It is okay for them not to want to participate. Do not force them. So moving into slide 20. So in summary, we review the five stages of grief, which is denial, anger, bargaining, depression, acceptance. We also discuss how you can support someone that is grieving. There are also ways to help children and teens with grief. So finally, let's review some available resources that you'll be able to use through your United Healthcare resources. So to assist people in improving health and well-being, we offered United Health Wellness, which is a comprehensive portfolio. You have myuhc.com. It is it's an essential resources for members looking to maximize their health care dollars and achieve better health. When you go onto myuhc.com, you'll find your different tools and resources that's available to you, right? There's also Rally, and Rally's there to help you make simple changes to your daily routine. You can do missions to breathe, to meditate, to exercise, mindfulness missions. You can set smart goals and stay on target. So after completing like your health survey, you will see the different missions that you can tap into. There's also a 24/7 nurse support through your health advocate. You call the number on the back of your card. You can always reach out to a health advocate. There's a United Healthcare pregnancy app. So if you have suffered a loss, miscarriage, reach out to one of the nurses and they will help you through that process. You also have, there are also medically approved pregnancy information that you can tap into. I know they'll go over like checking symptoms. You'll learn about expected labor or your next doctor's visit, or if you are experiencing preterm labor or preterm contractions, I know they will walk you through the process and guide you and help you with that. There are also different apps that you can download to help keep up with your weight and your eating habits and monitoring your diabetes and your blood pressure. Moving into slide 22,
The
San
Slumbering
Velo
Party.
app. The San Velo app
Oh,
is awesome.
anything
Some
simple.
members, everyone has access to the Sanvelo app, and this is a behavioral health app offering support on mindfulness, meditation, and social connection that is accessible anytime, anywhere. I use it. I use it all the time. I use it for mood tracking. I use it for guided journeys. So with mood tracking, you remember what I use it for, you can actually, there are simple questions each day that captures your mood and then identifying patterns and self-access processes. You can use it. There are coping tools. Members can find tools to help them relax, to be in the moment, or manage stressful situations such as test taking, public speaking, or just morning dread. You have guided journeys. I love the guided journeys. They're designed by expert for a range of needs, like journeys, use clinical techniques to help members feel more in control and build long-term life skills. There are also community resources that you can tap into through the Sanvelo app, and the Sanvelo mobile application shouldn't be used for urgent needs, right? You should always try to reach out to a professional. You have the virtual behavioral health virtual visit that you can tap into for that. But through your daily activities and whenever you just need to connect, the Sanvelo app is always there for you. Use it. It will actually help you. I have personally used it myself. I can tell you it's not intended to diagnose problems or provide treatment, but it is there to basically provide support and to give you resources and to help you through stressful situations. So if you haven't already downloaded that app, it's available to you. Make sure you download it, utilize it as part of your resources, connect with it. And with that being said, I will stop to see if there are any questions, if there are any concerns, anything anyone wants to share. We're here. We have 4 minutes. So I know with COVID, pandemic, most of us have we know we have experience loss, grief, whether it's personal, close family members, it may be a friend or a relative, it may be a colleague, coworker, it may be a pet, it may be from a loss of a job, it may be from loss of resources, finances. We've all been affected somehow or know someone who have been affected. It is very important during this time or these times that we take care of ourselves, that we're very mindful of others, that we're kind to others. You never know what someone else is going through. That smile on the face is not necessarily a big smile on the face. Sometimes people put up a smile just to get through their day, and that's how they cope. So just be mindful when you pass someone in the hallway or when you see someone being reserved, just say hello, start up a conversation. Or if you don't start up a conversation, just be kind, open the door, share a bottle of water, share a good morning, and just be kind to each other. And just remember that we all have burdens that we're carrying, and we all are going through personal issues, or we know someone who have gone through it, and we're still coping. We're still going through a pandemic. We're still going through serious times. There are many things that's happening around us, and people are dying, sudden deaths. Just be kind to each other, and just be mindful of how we treat each other. And with that, I will end the presentation and listen for someone else to speak.
Thank you very much, Gail. It was great.
Thank you. And thank you for joining. And I hope you at least take one thing away. And if you don't take anything away, just be kind to yourself. Don't judge yourself. Just be kind to yourself, compassion, and don't judge. And just look out for your colleagues and your friends and your coworkers and your family and even strangers and your neighbors.